الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره، ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم، إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم، إنك حميد مجيد. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I'm quite honored to be amongst you once again. Alhamdulillah that Allah gathered us in a beautiful, mashallah, you really did good with the organization inside the masjid here, and you have the Imam Abu Abdullah, Brother Sayyid. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to bless him and bless you and unite you always for the cause of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When I asked what would you like me to address during my visit, the question came, we just want to know what Iman means. What is Iman? Have you ever asked yourself this question? What is Iman? We're not talking about the articles of Iman. The articles of Iman is the belief in Allah, the angels, the books, the messengers, the day of resurrection, and al-Qadr, the six articles which you all memorize. But really, the definition of Iman as a theology, from a theology perspective, what is Iman? That's what they want me to address. And I want to tell you that this subject is so much related to what is happening in the world right now. The evolving of the so-called ISIS is really in the depth of this subject. You normally hear the word, oh, they are Khawarij. Right? Don't you hear that? They describe them right away to be what? To be Khawarij. Khawarij is actually a brand of Muslims who defined Iman differently. And you probably hear this for the first time in your lives. The definition of Iman was the first subject the Muslims disagreed upon. The first subject of disagreement. But be careful. There is a consensus on a certain definition. You understand? So the differing happened after what? After agreement. So the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam agreed to a certain definition for Iman. But then the groups started developing their own definition of Iman. Normally, academically, if you define something, first, you define it linguistically. The word Iman is an Arabic word. Hence, it has roots in the Arabic language. Why it's called this way? The scholars really ended up with different explanation for this. But the best one that I should share with you, Iman derives from Al-Amn. Amn means security, being secure. So when you have Iman, you're secure. وَمِنْهُ قَوْلُ اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. Look at this. إِنَّ الْمُتَّقِينَ فِي مَقَامٍ أَمِينٍ. Indeed, the righteous and the pious will be dwelling in a residence that is secure, which is what? In the hereafter, which is what? Jannah is what? One of the things about Jannah is what? تحيتهم فيها, the greeting is what? Salam. Salam. You are in this world, you're not secure. You're not. You go through the what we call it the roller coaster. The roller coaster. One day what? One day up, one day down, one day up, one day down. عالم. Now, what is the relationship between Iman and that concept of security? Remember that statement. You will never have peace and security unless or until you make peace with Allah. You submit to Allah. The moment that you submit to Allah, then Allah will give you amn, will give you peace. And that explains a lot to you how a lot of the human beings are troubled. I don't know if you heard this before or not, but this is from the American Medical Journal, that one out of each American, the year 2010, reported depression. Reported depression. There are people, you know, depression is something that sometimes is personal. You don't want to. There are people who are reluctant to reveal that. Why? Because they have not made peace with Allah. How do you make peace with Allah? By submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is why, ya ikhwa, look, when we finish the salah, what do we say? Astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. Allahumma anta, oh Allah, you are what? Translate this properly. How do you translate properly? You are the source of peace. Why Allah is the source of peace? Because nothing changes Allah. What happens doesn't affect Allah. That's why He provides peace for us. Allahumma anta as-salam, wa minka as-salam. And from you comes the peace. I submit it to you, Ya Rab. I surrendered. Here I am. Just finished my salah. Give me some peace. Give me some tranquility. Give me some serenity. Oh. So do you see the relationship between Iman linguistically, huh, and the overall concept of Iman? That when you actually believe in Allah, when you actually submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah grants you what? That peace and tranquility, which is something that we all need. Tayyib. This is Iman what? Linguistically. This is one way. What is Iman technically? Like I said, you read the books, you end up with multiple definitions. And the scholars, they call this a difference of variety, not a difference of opinion, not a difference of contradiction. Like when you start the salah, Allahu Akbar, what do you say after Allahu Akbar? Recommended. It's not a pillar, it's not, but it's one of the recommended acts of the salah. We say something called what? It's called what? Du'a'ul-i. The opening dua for the salah. It's called dua al-istiftah. How many dua can you come up with? Many. You can actually say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 duas. So you can do one, you can do two. You don't have to do all of them. Likewise, when there is a definition for Iman, when there is a definition for Iman, there are different ways to define Iman. But all of them mean the same thing. It's called the difference of variety. طيب. Here is some of the definitions which we find in the books. الإيمان قول وعمل. Iman, that you say and you act. Saying an action. الإيمان قول وعمل ونية. Saying an action and intention. Here is the definition that we're looking for. And I don't want to confuse you. Look at this. Faith Iman is a compound of four components. Four components. Number one, the belief of the heart, the action of the heart, the saying of the tongue, and the action of the limbs. Four. The belief of the heart, which is the tasdiq. Two, the action of the heart, which is intention, sincerity, reliance, fear, love. You do this with your heart. Then the saying of the tongue, then the action of the limbs. The definition is not over yet. Important. يزيد وينقص. It increases and decreases. It goes up and down. It's not a solid reality. It's not one thing. It increases and decreases. Let's go over those four quickly. What do we mean by تصديق القلب? Listen to this. That you firmly believe that Allah exists. And underline that word firmly. Beyond any shadow of doubt. That's why a Muslim cannot say, well, Allah exists. Yeah, He exists, but you know, Tasdiq. This is the foundation of faith, by the way, tasdiq. That you firmly believe that Allah exists. Two, Allah is the creator of everything. Allah khaliqu kulli shay. Quran. Allah is the creator of everything that exists. Two, He is the sovereign. He owns everything. He takes care, the nourisher of everything. He is the one who has the most beautiful names, the most lofty attributes. That is why the only one deserves worship and submission is Allah. That's tasdiq. And you believe that He sent angels, He had books, and there is a day of resurrection. You make tasdiq of this. Again, the issue of tasdiq, making tasdiq, which is firmly believe, is a very crucial issue, because if you doubt, then your iman is nullified. And a lot of people are skeptical now about some of the things in the religion, and they try actually to make you become skeptical. Like these TV shows now we have in Egypt, they try to cast doubts into the hearts, minds of a lot of Muslims that there is no such a thing called punishment in the grave. They tell you there is no punishment in the grave. No, you must believe that there is what? I'll give you an ideal example. Something happened 2 years ago in December 2013, if I'm not mistaken. We had that thing on the 22nd of December that the world will end, right? You remember that? Huh? You got Muslims calling you and asking you, Sheikh, is that correct or not? You know, their iman is nullified. Of course, I'm not calling them kuffar here, because I'm sure they are ignorant. Al-udhr bil-jahl. We're giving excuse because of what? But you making that statement, you entertaining the thought that there is somebody in the face of this earth who knows when this world will end, your iman is nullified. Why? Because Jibreel alayhi salam, when he came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a form of a man, he asked him this question, when is the hour? What was the answer? You remember what is the answer? Hadith Jibreel, what was the answer? The one who is being asked doesn't know any better than the one who is what? Asking. Hatta we believe that Israfil, there is an angel whose name is Israfil. As we speak, al-hadith fi Mustadrak al-Hakim wa Musnad Ahmad, hadith Abi Sa'id al-Khudri radiyallahu anhu, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, كيف أنعم وقد التقم صاحب القرن القرن وأحنى جبهته وأصغى سمعه ينتظر متى يؤمر أن ينفخ في الصور. How can I rejoice, enjoy this life when the bearer of the horn is holding the horn in his mouth and standing, he doesn't blink, looking at the throne of Allah, waiting for Allah to tell him, now is the hour. Now you think some culture from 5,000, 6,000 years ago will know when the hour is, and you believe in that? Then your iman is what? I want to tell you. Belief matters, belief issues that you don't doubt them at all. You're certain. You know, I don't want to prolong this. I want to make this short because I would like you to come tomorrow, inshallah, where we will expound more on this subject. But for you to understand this, في صحيح البخاري, a man came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, فقال رسول الله, he said, O Messenger of Allah, إن أخي استطلق بطنه. My brother, يعني he really expressed it in a nicer way. He said he's having diarrhea. His stomach is what? Loose. الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم, based on the verse in Surah An-Nahl, huh? There is a chapter in the Quran called An-Nahl. What does An-Nahl means? The bees. يخرج من بطونها, out of the bellies of the bees, شراب, a drink, مختلف ألوانه, with multiple colors, فيه شفاء للناس. It cures. قال اسقه عسلا. Give him honey. So, you know, right now, the Sahabi, the companion, okay, you know, we'll try it. So what? So he went home, and he given his brother honey. He came back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he said, Ya Rasulallah, O Messenger of Allah, ما زاده العسل إلا استطلاقا. I given him honey, but what the honey did, it increased what? He's having more diarrhea now. Look what the Prophet said to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. اسقيه عسل. Give him honey. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam figured out that this companion is what? He doesn't have yaqeen, certainty. Yeah. We're talking about the first, I haven't gone out of the subject of iman here. We're talking about what? Tasdeeq. Making tasdeeq, which is what? The foundation that you believe in everything that you're told in the Quran and in the authentic hadith without any doubt. Any doubt. Because the moment that you doubt, guess what? Your commitment, your conviction to action will fade away. Oh, it's maybe. I'm not going to do it. وذاك شوف تعريف المؤمن. I'll go back to the story. إنما المؤمنون, indeed the true believers, الذين آمنوا بالله ورسوله, those who believe in Allah and His Messenger, ثم لم يرتابوا, then they don't ever doubt anything that Allah and His Messenger tell them. Because as a result of this, look, the verse is not over yet. وَجَاهَدُوا فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ بِأَمْوَالِهِمْ وَأَنفُسِهِمْ. They will strive now with their wealth. Listen, I'm going to pray 5 times a day, man. Huh? I'm going to give money out. I'm going to give money. Why Rasul says, وَالصَّدَقَ بُرْهَانٌ. Sadaqah is an evidence. Evidence for what? Evidence for what? That you believe Allah will reward you for it. If you don't believe that, if you don't make tasdeeq of that, guess what? You're not going to give. You're not. We go back to the story here. Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sensed that the companion's certainty is, look, the second time, اسقه عسل, give him honey. So he went and he given him honey. And he came back. Look back. Well, sometimes Allah tries you. His brother was not cured. So he returned to the Prophet ﷺ. قال رسول الله, my brother is still sick. What you prescribed for me is not working. You know what the Prophet said to him ﷺ? اسقه عسلا. Give him honey. But he added something this time. صدق الله وكذب بطن أخيك. Allah spoke the truth and the stomach of your brother is lying. شوف شوف اليقين. He went this time after he saw that certainty in the language of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he went home and he given him honey. His brother was cured. قال شفي يا أخي شفي يا أخي يا رسول الله. Right now, actually, the brothers in the field of medicine, they give an explanation to this. That normally honey with diarrhea, because there is a virus in the stomach, so what does it do? It does what first? It expels everything out, then what? Holds the stomach. Actually, there is an explanation for it. Like I tell you another example we have in the Sunnah, you know. We have hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari. That if you have a glass of water in front of you, and if a fly dips its wing in it, what should you do? Listen, if you want to drink that glass, if you don't want to drink it, go ahead and spill it. But guess what? There are some scenarios that you could be in a desert, and the only water available for you is what? What should you do then? Dip the other wing. طبعاً. Brothers who are into that progressive religion, Muslims, you know, progressive Muslims. Ya akhi, don't narrate that stuff. Non-Muslims, they will say that we were drinking insects and mosquitoes. Ya akhi, there is a wisdom. There is a wisdom. Yaqeen. You must have certainty in every single thing that Allah and His Messenger tell you. Even if your intellect does not what? Absorb it, does not consume it, does not digest it. You don't use your intellect to judge the text, but you make tasdeeq of it. Just to for you really to understand it, because the subject of tasdeeq is the key. So we said that you must make tasdeeq with certainty. They tell you that below certainty, there are three levels that you cannot have. If you have any of these levels, then you're no longer a Muslim. You're no longer a mu'min. Your iman is incomplete. The first level, they call it al-wahm. What is al-wahm? The best term that I found in English is delusion. That you really don't know the subject and you're deluded. You just don't know. They tell you that there is a day of judgment. Oh, yes. And this is someone who lacks the knowledge completely. Has zero knowledge about the subject. Look at the second level. The second level is what? Is doubt. Shak. Raib. What is shak? 50-50. I ask you, there is a day of resurrection? Yeah, maybe. You're what? 50-50. Again, these three levels are what? Red zone. If you have any of those, that means you're what? You're not. You're not a mu'min. No iman. Because iman must be with what? Certainty. Yaqeen. What is the next level? They call it dhan. Suspicion. That you believe. Listen to this. 99.9999999999999, but you still have that what? No, you can't. 100% yaqeen. And actually, there are three levels up. Our yaqeen is not the same, by the way. Probably some of yours yaqeen is much better than my yaqeen. And these three levels were mentioned in the Quran. علم اليقين عين اليقين حق اليقين. What is علم اليقين? That you have the knowledge that give you certainty. That you read the Quran, your will established in aqeedah, you have studied the subject of iman. And you know what it means. You have ilm, you have knowledge. Ilm al-yaqeen. Kalla law ta'lamuna ilm al-yaqeen. The second level is what? عين. When you see it, عين اليقين. Listen, when Ibrahim عليه السلام asked Allah to show him how he resurrects the dead, you know the verse in Surah Al-Baqarah? وَإِذْ قَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمُ رَبِّ أَرِنِي كَيْفَ تُحْيِي الْمَوْتَى. Ibrahim said to Allah, can you make me see how you resurrect the dead? Ibrahim had certainty. But what type of certainty did he have? علم. But he wanted to elevate to what? عين. He wanted to see it happening. That's. And if you really want to, but let me tell you the third level, حق, when you actually taste it, when you actually touch it. Allah said to Ibrahim, actually, I will make you do it. You take the birds, chop them, place them here, call upon them. I will make, this is حق, the truth of certainty. You probably heard this hadith a couple of times before. There is a companion whose name is Hanzala. I'm sorry. One day he came to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq and he said, what? Nafaqa Hanzala. Hanzala is a hypocrite. Abu Bakr looked at him and said, what do you mean you're a hypocrite? He said, إِذَا كُنَّا مَعَ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. When we are with the Messenger of Allah, he would describe for us Jannah and Hell. Look at this. كَأَنَّا نَرَاهَا رَأْيَ عَيْنِ. Our iman, our yaqeen is up, the eye of certainty, as if we see hell and we see Jannah. So the yaqeen is what? Is up from just the knowledge to what? As if you see it. Look why he's considering himself a hypocrite. He's not a hypocrite. But he just went down because we said iman what? Yaqeen is what? Goes up and down. But when we go home and the wife, can you take the trash out? Can you go and buy diapers for the kid, size 5? Your iman what? But it goes until what? علم اليقين. It doesn't go below. There is a level that you cannot go beneath it. Hanzala considered himself a hypocrite because of this. Because he wanted what? To maintain what? Ayn. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq looked at him. I'm like you. Then I'm a hypocrite like you. If this is, how are we going to measure things? So they went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and they described for him what they experienced. He said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you stick around me all the time, you will reach to haqq al-yaqeen. What's haqq al-yaqeen? You will shake the hands of the angels in the roads. Your iman, you understand? So your certainty actually is not, it fluctuates, goes up and down. But the least you must have is what? The knowledge of what? Of certainty. And that's why a gathering like this feeds your iman. Gives you certainty. فالتصديق. You must believe in Allah. Allah exists. You can't be skeptical about this. I think I was in California last weekend, and I was asked this question by a sister. Sheikh, I pray 5 times. And I, but sometimes I have doubts that Allah exists. I said, sister, this is a big issue. You have actually to treat that issue because this nullifies your iman. And the way to treat this is what? Is to elevate your knowledge. Is to study the belief system. So, we go back to those 4 components. Tasdeeq. Now if you make tasdeeq, if you have tasdeeq, if you firmly believe that Allah exists, and there is a day of resurrection, and you're going to stand for judgment, and there is Jannah and there is hell, then that tasdeeq, look at this, creates the will, or through that tasdeeq, Allah creates the will inside your heart that now you want to act. Khalas, you have the intention. Now I'm going to pray 5 times. Man, there is hell, there is Jannah. Listen, if I don't pray, the first thing I'm going to be asked about is a salah. Man, I got to stop cheating, stop lying. It's haram. I'm going to have to pay for this in the day for salah. So now you start what? Intending to work with certainty, you start what? Developing actions, the action of the heart. Then the tongue speaks, then the rest of the limbs act. And it increases and decreases. Very quickly before you go home today. And inshallah, we're going to go over this again tomorrow in more details. So this is the definition that the ummah agreed upon. We have consensus upon. Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah, said, I have met 1,000 from the scholars of this ummah. All of them define iman to be this way, at increases and decreases. Al-Iman, actions, action of the heart, action of the body, beliefs of the heart, and the saying of the tongue, it increases and decreases. This is the middle way to define Iman. You end up with two groups in the Ummah, two extremes. Normally, scholars, they begin with the fanatic one, the likeness of that group ISIS. But I will break that and I will begin with the first group, which actually the majority of the Muslims are this way. What group I'm talking about? They say Iman, faith is tasdiq. That you believe Allah exists, there is Jannah, there is Hell, and that's it. Top the action, there is no need for it. If you pray, it's okay. If you, it's a compliment. It's not a condition. It's not a component of Iman. It's an extra. We call those irja', murji'ah. أخروا العمل. They say as long as you have tasdeeq. And every culture, by the way, developed its own brand or terms. Don't you find people, I have Allah in my heart. My heart is so white. My heart is so clean. When you ask them, why don't you pray? My heart is clean. That's what matters. He's saying what? Iman is what? Just tasdeeq. That you believe Allah exists. There is Jannah. There is Hell. Yeah, and sometimes they tell you, can you just please say La ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah so you can marry a Muslim woman, and if you invite me to your house, I can eat your meat. Huh? Just because there are some religious rulings which are what? Connected to the fact that you're a Muslim. Janaza, say salam to you. Fi hajat. Just say La ilaha illallah so I know that you're a Muslim. This one extreme. And the majority of the Muslims belong to that group, to that brand, Al-Irja. Don't you brothers have in this masjid Ramadani Muslims? Don't you have Eid Muslims? Isn't the number of the Muslims on the day of Eid kind of increases in our communities, the size? These are brothers who what? Who believe that Iman is what? All that other stuff is what? That's an extreme. هذا إرجاء مشكلة هذا. And I always tell that story when I was leading صلاة العيد في واشنطن. This brother, you know, we have that variation between أبي حنيفة and الجمهور regarding the number of تكبيرات for صلاة العيد. But there is difference of opinion. I did the 7 and 5. He came to me after the صلاة instead of saying عيد مبارك happy عيد, he just blown me. And he said, you know what? I will complain to Allah against you. You messed up the only salah I observe in the year. He's true. He actually believes that Iman tasdeeq is just tasdeeq. Some Muslims are like this, by the way, and they swear knowledge. You need to pour knowledge. Because I cannot call this brother a kafir, by the way. I can't, because I'm 100% positive that he's what? He's doing this out of what? Not knowing. So this is one extreme. There is another extreme to this, and I close with this today, and I promise you, which is the like of ISIS, these groups. And this is how they justify the killing and the burning. They say what? Remember when we defined Iman according to Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, what Iman does what? In a gathering like this, I assure you, your Iman went up a little bit. يعني, inshallah. I'm certain. My Iman kind of went up. Iman does what? Raises and they say what? Iman is a solid reality. If you harm it, it's gone. إذا ذهب بعضه ذهب كله. If some of it is gone, the rest of it is gone. Meaning what? If you commit a major sin, you're kafir. خلاص. And you stay in hell for eternity. هذا كلام. And this is how they justify by what? How they justify the killing and the burning of people? Of course you can repent. They say that you can repent. But there is one sin out there they use that it's impossible to repent of. When you support a system that rules according to man-made laws. And you support it actually by not fighting it. Like if you're living in a country where the leadership does not rule according to the Sharia, so the ruler is what? Kafir, and anyone supports him is what? Is kafir. If you work for the government, you're a kafir. No. That Muhammad, listen, to kill somebody, you must found what? You must establish what? Why you're doing it. And that's how they do it. By labeling the society, the community, to be what? Kuffar. Ya ikhwa, we're very disciplined as Muslims once it comes to labeling another Muslim to be a kafir. I always make that statement in my lectures. The fastest way to leave Islam is to call another Muslim a kafir. You know why? I'm basing this on a hadith. Hadith Abdullah ibn Umar, radiallahu anhuma, fi al-sahihain. Because if he is not, then what? Then you are. It goes back to you. If that person is not, then it goes back to you. Now, does this mean that we don't label people at all to be kuffar? Yes, we do. But we're disciplined. First of all, the scholars, they say what? There is takfir mutlaq. There is unrestricted takfir. How? Listen, I can tell you right now, whoever steps in the mushaf to humiliate it or disgrace it is a kafir. Whoever. I say what? This is called what? Unrestricted takfir. Whoever. A general what? Statement. But to see somebody who's stepping in the mushaf in front of me, I cannot tell him a kafir. I can't. Until I do three things. Maybe he's ignorant. I must educate him. Maybe he sat in front of somebody like me and given him the impression that actually to raise the mushaf is to step on it. We call this what? Ta'wil. Faulty interpretation. Al-udhr bit-ta'wil. He may have made a mistake in understanding a verse. Oh. Three. Two. Four. Maybe he's forced. Somebody is forcing him to do this. So I must remove those. And even with that, even with those, I leave this task to learn people, to scholars. And not just a scholar, a group of scholars. You see, we're very careful. But we can do unrestricted takfir. Say what? Whoever refuses to pray knowingly, rejecting the command is a kafir. Whoever halalize, you know what halalize means? Huh? What halalize? Makes halal. Something haram knowingly is a kafir. Whoever. This is what unrestricted takfir mutlaq. But some individual does this. Ta'ala ya akhi, ta'ala assalamu alaykum. I'm your brother, ta'ala. Why are you doing this? Ilm. Allah said, the Quran said, the Sunnah said, the scholar Abi Hanifa, Malik, Shafi'i, they said this and this. You try what? The process of what? Of education. But they don't do this. They right away label people to be what? Of this nature. This is just a taste tonight of Iman. Inshallah, the subject is very rich and wealthy and a beautiful subject. It's theology. It's just understanding where you stand on these fundamental issues. And I just want to tell you that when a Muslim would accept Islam at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the first subject he will learn before the Quran is al-Iman. What Iman is? Shuf, the companion, I believe his name is, will come inshallah. He came to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Atayna Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when we were young. Fata'allamna al-Iman. Then we learned what Iman is, then we learned the Quran. And the Quran increased our Iman. Jarir ibn Abdullah al-Bajali, that's the companion. Jarir ibn Abdullah. So, ولذلك التفسير نور على نور, the light of the Quran on the top of the light of Iman. Here is Abdullah ibn Umar says, we learned Iman, then we learned Quran, that's why we implement the Quran. And time will come when people learn the Quran before learning what Iman is. And they will recite it, it will not even go down their throat. That means it doesn't what? Touch the heart. You may have beautiful recitation, but it doesn't what? Because the Iman is not there. It's a beautiful subject, you know, and imagine talking about Iman, you know, talking about Iman, inshallah. So, I mean, I love you all for the sake of you're sitting like you want me to speak on, but I don't want to prolong this. Tomorrow, inshallah, I promise you, we'll have an extended presentation of this. But I just want to let you know that I came from Denver because we are starting a project there, Dar Tawheed. You know, I was told you're sick and tired of fundraising. So I understand that you had a couple of them, but I'm coming actually to ask your support and help. Not tonight, tomorrow, inshallah, bi idhnillahi ta'ala. We want to establish a masjid called Dar Tawheed. The closing actually on this property is on Monday, inshallah. You make dua for us. We need your dua first of all, bi idhnillahi ta'ala. A masjid and a community center and a hifz school that I will personally be the principal and in charge of it. I want to bring that generation, inshallah, in Denver, where they, you know, memorize the Quran, but I want to teach them Iman beforehand, inshallah. And I'm actually going to be teaching myself in this school, beside being the principal of it, inshallah. Alhamdulillah, I had a lot of good brothers, actually nationwide, who helped me close on Monday through goodly loans. You know, they, mashallah, alhamdulillah, a lot of the brothers giving goodly loans. But Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, whoever takes the money of people with the intention of giving it back, Allah will give him support and help. And whoever takes it with the intention of not repaying it, Allah will destroy his wealth. And wallahi, whenever I take a dollar in goodly loan from a Muslim brother, I always remind myself with this hadith. And one of the means that I come to the places where brothers know me and know what I've been doing, and ask whatever they can help. If they cannot, then their dua is more sufficient, inshallah. So I'll be here for Jum'ah, inshallah, and tomorrow we're having dinner for you here, and inshallah we'll have a short presentation, we'll have a presentation about Isha, and I will show you the project, inshallah, what we're doing, give you some pictures of it, and let you know where we stand, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you Jannah, Rabbil Alameen. And I have to say this, wallahi, it's a treat for me that to get to see you again, you know, some new faces are here, but some familiar faces. I love you all for the sake of Allah. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to gather us with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fil Jannah, ya Rabbil Alameen. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us amongst those who who leave this world with iman, with faith, with certainty, so that we can make it to Jannah, Rabbil Alameen. And life is not fun, you know, we're going through it, but Allah make it easy on us, Ya Rabbil Alameen. جزاكم الله خيرا سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك والحمد لله رب العالمين.